Hello friends, welcome to this video on quadrilaterals. In the previous video, we discussed about quadrilaterals and its types. Today, we will discuss about the angle sum property of a quadrilateral. So let's start. Friends, we have studied the angle sum property of a triangle. We know that a triangle has three angles and the sum of the three angles of a triangle is 180 degrees. A quadrilateral has four angles. Can you guess what will be the sum of all the angles of a quadrilateral? Let's do an activity to understand it. Let's create two triangles with the same base on a paper. Let's name the first triangle as PQR and the second triangle as QRS. We know that the sum of the three angles of a triangle is 180 degrees. Now, let's connect these two triangles to the base QR. So, the sum of all the angles of this shape so formed will be 360 degrees and this shape is a quadrilateral. In comparison to the triangle, a quadrilateral has one extra angle, but the sum of the angles of a quadrilateral is two times the sum of the angles of a triangle. This is what we call the angle sum property of a quadrilateral. We tested this property through an activity. Let us now try to prove it mathematically. Let's make a quadrilateral ABCD. We have to prove that angle A plus angle B plus angle C plus angle D is equal to 360 degrees. Now, by drawing a diagonal of this quadrilateral, let's divide this quadrilateral into two triangles. You can create either one of the diagonals AC or BD. Now we have two triangles, triangle BCD and triangle DAB. In triangle BCD, angle CBD plus angle C plus angle CDB equals 180 degrees. According to the angle sum property of a triangle, similarly, in triangle DAB, angle ADB plus angle A plus angle ABD equals 180 degrees. Adding equations 1 and 2, we get. Now, when we add angle CBD and angle ABD, we get angle B. Similarly, on adding angle CDB and angle ADB, we get angle D. We can also write it in this way. Angle B plus angle C plus angle D plus angle A equals 360 degrees or angle A plus angle B plus angle C plus angle D equals 360 degrees. And thus we prove that the sum of the four angles of any quadrilateral is 360 degrees. Before ending this session, here is an activity. Do this together with your classmates. In the end, you will find that even though these quadrilaterals are different and smaller or bigger in size, the sum of the measurements of their internal angles is 360 degrees. That's all in this session. Today we discussed the angle sum property of a quadrilateral. In the next video, we will solve some questions based on this topic. Thank you. Hello friends, welcome to this video on quadrilaterals. In the previous video, we discussed the angle sum property of a quadrilateral. Today, we will solve some questions related to that topic only. So let's start. In quadrilateral PQRS, angle P, angle Q, angle R and angle S are in the ratio of 1 is to 2 is to 3 is to 4. Find the measure of all its angles. Friends, assume that the measure of angle P, angle Q, angle R and angle S is x, 2x, 3x and 4x respectively. And we know that the sum of the angles of a quadrilateral is 360 degrees. Therefore, angle P plus angle Q plus angle R plus angle S equals 360 degrees. We can also write this as x plus 2x plus 3x plus 4x equals 360 degrees. The sum of the left side will be 10x. Solving it, we will get x equals 36 degree. We have got the measure of x, that is the measure of angle P. With the help of this, we can find the measure of the remaining angles. The measurement of the remaining angles will be as follows. The measurement of angle P, angle Q, angle R and angle S will be 36, 72, 108 and 144 degrees respectively. You can add all these angles and see that their sum will be 360 degrees. Let us see another similar question. The ratio of the angles of the quadrilateral EFGH is given as follows. Construct a quadrilateral based on the given ratio and describe its type. Friends, using this hint, try to solve this question on your own. Let's move on to the next question. In quadrilateral ABCD, the measure of angle B is 2 times the measure of angle A, and the measure of angle D is 3 times the measure of angle C, and the sum of angles A and C is 105 degrees. Then find the measure of each angle. Friends, is there a need to draw a figure here? No. We can solve this question without drawing any figure. We are given that the measure of angle B is 2 times the measure of angle A. So, if we take angle A as X, then angle B will be 2X. Similarly, the measure of angle D is 3 times the measure of angle C. So, if we take angle C as Y, then angle D will be 3Y. It is also given that angle A plus angle C is equal to 105 degrees. Angle A and angle C can also be written as X and Y in this way. Let us call this equation 1. We know that the sum of all the angles of a quadrilateral is 360 degrees. Let's call this equation 2. Now by putting the values of angles A, B, C and D in equation 2, we will get... If you simplify it a bit, you will get... Let us call it equation 3. Friends, we can write equation 3 like this as well. Now, by placing the value of equation 1 in it, we can find the value of y. We got y equal to 45 degrees. Now, by putting the value of y in equation 1, we can find the value of x. That is, angle A is equal to x is equal to 60 degrees and angle C is equal to y is equal to 45 degrees. And angle B and angle D will be as follows. Angle B equals 120 degrees, angle D equals 135 degrees. Thus, we got the measurement of all the angles. Friends, that's all in this session. Today, we solved some questions related to the angle sum property of a quadrilateral. In the next session, we will discuss some facts related to this topic. Thank you. Hello friends. Welcome to this video on quadrilaterals. In the previous video, we solved some questions related to the angle sum property of a quadrilateral. In today's video, we will discuss some more facts based on the same topic and increase our knowledge on this subject. So let's start this session with a question. Look at the given figure and find the measure of angle Y. Friends, here we are given the measurement of two internal and one external angle of the quadrilateral and we have to find the measurement of the remaining one angle. Here we will first find the measure of angle W. We know that when an angle forms a complete circle, its measure is 360 degrees. Therefore, the sum of the measurements of exterior angle XWZ and interior angle XWZ will be 360 degrees. We are given the measurement of the exterior angle XWZ as 290 degrees. Using this, we can find the measure of the interior angle XWZ. We got the measure of the interior angle XWZ as 70 degrees. Now we have the measurement of the three interior angles of the quadrilateral. We can easily find the measurement of the fourth angle in this way. We got the measurement of angle Y as 60 degrees. Let's take one more question. Friends, to show or prove the angle sum property of the quadrilateral, we have divided it into two triangles. With the help of the same concept, find the angle sum property of a hexagon. Friends, how do we solve this question? Pause the video and think about it. Here, the first task will be to construct a triangle by drawing a line from any one vertex to another non-adjacent vertex in such a way that the lines do not intersect each other. And then see how many triangles we are getting. And then multiply the number of triangles obtained by 180 degrees. The product obtained will be the sum of all the angles of a hexagon. You can see that we have got four triangles. That is, the sum of all the angles of a hexagon will be 4 multiplied by 180 degree is equal to 720 degrees. Let's see another interesting question of this type. How many maximum acute angles will be needed to construct one quadrilateral? Friends, you can also pause the video to think about the answer to this question. We have to see whether it is possible to construct a quadrilateral in the given three situations. Let's take the first option and take a group of four angles such that there is only one acute angle like this. We can see that the construction of a quadrilateral is possible here. Similarly, for the remaining two options also, let's create a group of angles in such a way that there are two and three acute angles respectively. You can still see that the construction of a quadrilateral is possible. According to the question, we have to find the maximum number of acute angles, so the correct option will be 3. But friends, is it possible to construct a quadrilateral from 4 acute angles? You can throw light on this with the help of your teacher and classmates. Friends, that's all in this session. Today we discussed some facts related to the angle sum property of a quadrilateral. See you in the next video. Thank you. Hello friends. Welcome to the session on quadrilaterals. Today we will learn about quadrilaterals and their types. Do you see any similarities between these figures? Yes, you can see that all these figures have four sides. In the previous year, we have learned that such shapes are called quadrilaterals. We see many things around us in which we can see the shapes of quadrilaterals. For example, this part of the book, we can see its boundaries, which is the shape of the quadrilateral. Similarly, the boundary of each surface of this box, etc. Friends, a quadrilateral has four sides, four angles, and four vertices. And line segments formed by joining opposite vertices are called the diagonals. And all quadrilaterals have two diagonals. If a quadrilateral has a characteristic that its opposite sides are parallel, then these types of quadrilaterals are called as parallelogram. Friends, we know that opposite sides and opposite angles in a parallelogram are equal, and its two diagonals bisect each other. Hence, we can say that OA is equal to OC and BO is equal to OD. Now let's look at some special parallelograms. Friends, if all the sides of this parallelogram are equal, then what do we call it? You may pause the video and think of an answer. Yes, these types of parallelograms are called rhombus. Because a rhombus is a parallelogram whose all sides are equal, its two diagonals bisect each other vertically. Friends, in the previous year, we have learned about rectangle. This is a parallelogram whose all angles are right angles. It also has the properties of a parallelogram, that is, its opposite sides are parallel and equal. What if all the sides of rectangle are equal? The figure will look something like this. You are familiar with these types of shapes. You may pause the video to think of an answer. Yes, friends. This is a square. All its sides are equal and all the angles are 90 degrees. All the quadrilaterals we have seen so far have parallel opposite sides. But what about quadrilaterals which have only one pair of parallel sides? What do we call these types of quadrilaterals? You may pause the video to think about an answer. Friends, such quadrilaterals are called trapezium. Consider the sides which are not parallel. What if they are equal? Such trapeziums are called isosceles trapezium. Friends, you must have seen the kite. It looks like this. Its sides are not parallel. There are two pairs of adjacent sides whose lengths are equal. Such quadrilaterals are called kite. Its one diagonal bisects the other diagonal at right angle. Friends, that's it for today's session. Today, we discussed quadrilaterals and their types. Meet you in the next session. Thank you. Hello friends, welcome to this session on quadrilaterals. In the previous session, we learned about quadrilateral and its types. Today we will solve some questions related to the same. Based on the information given in the figures, identify the types of quadrilaterals. Friends, look at the first quadrilateral PQRS. Its four sides are equal and both pairs of opposite sides are parallel. Therefore, PQRS is a rhombus. Can we also call it a parallelogram? Yes, friends, because a rhombus is a parallelogram whose all sides are equal. Now look at the second figure. This is a parallelogram ABCD whose opposite sides are equal and each given angle is 90 degrees. You can pause the video and think to find which quadrilateral has such properties. Yes, this is a rectangle. In the third figure in the quadrilateral DEFG, only one pair of opposite sides are parallel and the other pair which are not parallel, both DG and EF are equal. Therefore, it is an isosceles trapezium. Look at the fourth figure. Friends, on seeing it, you can easily identify that this quadrilateral is called a kite. Its adjacent sides are equal. Look at the fifth figure. On observing this, you will know that it is not a quadrilateral because it has five sides. We can also call it a polygon or a pentagon. Let's move ahead. Let's see one more question. Here are some characteristics of quadrilaterals. Read them carefully and identify the quadrilateral. This is a parallelogram whose all sides are equal. The opposite sides of the parallelogram are parallel and equal. But all its sides are equal, so it can be rhombus. Friends, this can also be a square because all the sides of the square are equal to. No information on the angles are provided here. So according to this statement, it can either be a rhombus or a square. Friends, that's it for today's session. Today we solved some questions based on quadrilaterals and their types. Meet you in the next session. Thank you. Hello friends. Welcome to this session on quadrilaterals. In the previous session, we learned about quadrilaterals and their types. Today, we will discuss some facts related to the same. Let's start with our first question. All kites are rhombus. Answer whether this statement is true or false. Friends, as we know, kites have two pairs of different adjacent sides whose length is equal. And all the sides of the rhombus are equal. So both its adjacent sides will also be equal. It means any rhombus can also be a kite. But in kite, two pairs of different adjacent sides are equal and the opposite side is not equal. Therefore, the kite is not a rhombus. That is, the given statement is false. Let's go ahead and see the second statement. All parallelograms are trapezium. Tell whether this statement is true. By the definition of parallelogram, pair of its opposite sides are parallel. And to be trapezium, a pair of sides must be parallel. That is, the only condition we have to keep in mind is that a pair of sides must be parallel. Therefore, we can say that parallelograms are trapeziums. That is, the given statement is true. In the third statement, it is given that a square is also a rectangle and a rhombus. State whether the given statement is true or false. Friends, note that all the sides of the square are equal and the opposite sides are parallel. And each angle is right angle, that is 90 degrees. Even the angles of a rectangle are right angles and the opposite sides are parallel. But only its opposite sides are equal. But if all the sides of the square are equal, then definitely its opposite sides will be equal. Therefore, we can call a square a rectangle. All the sides of the rhombus are equal and the opposite sides are parallel. And its opposite angles are equal. Since all the angles of the square are 90 degrees, then the opposite angles will also be equal. Therefore, the square can also be called a rhombus. A square has all the properties of a rectangle and rhombus. Therefore, this statement is true. Friends, that's it for today's session. Today we discussed some facts about quadrilateral and its types. Meet you in the next session. Thank you. Hello friends, welcome to this video on quadrilaterals. In the previous video, we discussed about quadrilateral and its types. We specifically studied about parallelograms. Today we will discuss some properties of a parallelogram. Let's construct a parallelogram PQRS. If we combine these two vertices in this way to form diagonal QS, then we will get these two triangles. Can we say something about these triangles? Friends, will these two triangles be congruent? Let's check it out. This is a parallelogram. Therefore, side PQ is parallel to side SR and QS is the diagonal. So, both these angles PQS and angle RSQ will be equal as these are alternate interior angles. Similarly, angle PSQ and angle RQS will also be equal. Now look at triangles PSQ and RQS. Here, this pair of two angles are equal and side SQ is the common side. Therefore, both these triangles are congruent according to the ASA congruence rule. Now we can say that diagonal QS divides parallelogram PQRS into two congruent triangles. Friends, you can make diagonal PR in the same way and check the congruence of the triangles. You will come to the conclusion that diagonal PR also divides quadrilateral PQRS into two congruent triangles. Friends, this is the property of a parallelogram and we can write it as a theorem. A diagonal of a parallelogram divides it into two congruent triangles. And as we know that corresponding parts of congruent triangles are equal, therefore, the corresponding sides of these triangles will also be equal. That is, side PQ is equal to side RS and side PS is equal to side RQ. Friends, note that these sides are opposite sides of this parallelogram. This is another property of a parallelogram, and we can write this also as a theorem, that the opposite sides of a parallelogram are equal. Friends, will the converse of this theorem also be true? That is, if each pair of opposite sides of a quadrilateral is equal, then will that quadrilateral be a parallelogram? Suppose the opposite sides of quadrilateral ABCD are equal, then we have to prove that it is a parallelogram. That is, if we draw a diagonal AC here, then the alternate angles formed by the intersection of sides AB and DC are equal. So these lines will be parallel. With the help of these two triangles, triangle ABC and triangle CDA, we can prove them to be parallel. We can see that in both these triangles, side AB is equal to side CD, side BC is equal to side DA, and side AC is the common side. Hence, both these triangles are congruent according to the SSS congruence rule. That is, angle BAC and angle DCA will be equal and they form a pair of alternate angles. We know that if a transversal intersects two lines in such a way that a pair of alternate interior angles are equal, then the two lines are parallel. This means side AB will be parallel to side DC. Repeating the same process, by drawing diagonal BD, we can prove side AD also parallel to side BC. Now its opposite sides are parallel. Therefore, quadrilateral ABCD is a parallelogram. We can write this result in the form of a theorem as follows. If each pair of opposite sides of a quadrilateral is equal, then it is a parallelogram. Friends, we obtain this result for the opposite sides of a parallelogram. Can we say something about its opposite angles? Like the opposite sides of a parallelogram, will the pair of opposite angles also be equal? Let's check. Draw a parallelogram DEFG. Now with the help of a protractor, find the measure of its opposite angles. You can see that the measure of angle D and angle F is equal and the measure of angle E and angle G is also equal. Friends, by pausing this video, you can repeat this activity for other parallelograms. With this, you will come to the conclusion that the opposite angles of all parallelograms are equal. This is another property of a parallelogram. But will its converse also be true? Let's see. If we are given that in a quadrilateral ABCD, each pair of its opposite angles are equal, then will it be a parallelogram? Let's examine it. Friends, we have studied the angle sum property of a quadrilateral. Using it, we can write these angles as follows. As we are given that the measure of angle A is equal to angle C, and the measure of angle B is equal to angle D. Therefore, in equation 1, we can substitute angle A in place of angle C and angle B in place of angle D. Now, we can simplify equation 1 in this way. We will get angle A plus angle B is equal to 180 degrees. Look at the figure carefully. If side AB is considered to be the transversal of side AD and side BC, then angle A and angle B are the interior angles on the same side of the transversal, and the sum of these two angles is 180 degrees. These are supplementary angles. Friends, we know that if a transversal intersects two lines in such a way that one pair of interior angles on the same side of the transversal is supplementary, then the two lines are parallel to each other. Now using the theorem, we can say that AD and BC are parallel sides. Friends, repeating this activity by pausing the video, you can prove sides AB and DC to be parallel to each other. In this way, that is, we can say that the converse of the theorem is also true. Therefore, we can write it in the form of a theorem as follows. If each pair of opposite angles of a quadrilateral is equal, then that quadrilateral is a parallelogram. Friends, that's all in this session. Today we discussed some properties of a parallelogram and proved some theorem based on them. See you in the next video with some properties of a parallelogram. Thank you. Hello friends, welcome to this video on quadrilaterals. In the previous video, we discussed about some properties of a parallelogram. Today, we will see some more properties related to that. Friends, we know that the diagonal of a parallelogram divides it into two congruent triangles. If we construct both the diagonals of a parallelogram such that they intersect each other at O, then, what can you say by looking at it? Friends, the diagonals of a parallelogram bisect each other. Let's try to understand this property. According to the statement, AO should be equal to OC and BO should be equal to OD. Let's prove this. And this happens only if both these triangles are congruent to each other. That is, we have to prove that these two triangles are congruent. So let's start. Let's try to prove that triangle AOB and triangle COD are congruent. In both these triangles, side AB is equal to side CD. Can you explain the reason for this? Because we have read that the opposite sides of a parallelogram are equal. Here, side AB is parallel to side DC and BD is a diagonal. Therefore, angle ABO is equal to angle CDO and angle BAO is equal to angle DCO because both of these are alternate interior angles. And thus, both these triangles are congruent according to the angle side angle or ASA congruence rule. Hence, side AO is equal to side CO and side OB is equal to side OD, because the corresponding sides of congruent triangles are equal. Now we can say that the diagonals of a parallelogram bisect each other. Or let's say they divide it into two equal parts. Now, let's move to the next theorem. If the diagonals of a quadrilateral bisect each other, then that quadrilateral is a parallelogram. This is the converse of the previous theorem. That is, there is a quadrilateral ABCD whose diagonals bisect each other at point O. That is, AO is equal to OC and BO is equal to OD. So we have to prove that this quadrilateral is a parallelogram, or we can say that we have to prove that the opposite sides of this quadrilateral are parallel. So let's start. It is given that in triangle AOB and triangle COD, side AO is equal to side CO, side OB is equal to side OD. angle AOB is equal to angle COD because these are vertically opposite angles. Therefore, these two triangles are congruent by the SAS congruence rule. So, interior angle ABO is equal to angle CDO, corresponding angles of congruent triangles. These equal angles are alternate interior angles that are formed by the intersection of sides AB and DC with diagonal BD. Therefore, AB is parallel to DC. Similarly, we can prove AD and BC also to be parallel to each other. And now we can say that quadrilateral ABCD is a parallelogram. That is, if the diagonals of a quadrilateral bisect each other, then that quadrilateral is a parallelogram. Let's move to the last theorem. Try to prove this theorem with me. A quadrilateral is a parallelogram if a pair of its opposite sides is equal and parallel. Friends, can you tell how you will prove this? Let's see. Suppose we have quadrilateral PQRS in which PQ and RS are equal and parallel to each other. If we prove these sides, side QR and side SP, to be equal, then this quadrilateral will be a parallelogram, because we know that if a pair of opposite sides of a quadrilateral is equal and parallel, then that quadrilateral is a parallelogram. Therefore, we will prove the congruence of two triangles which consists of sides QR and SP. Here, we will draw diagonal QS. Now we have triangle SPQ and triangle QRS. In triangle SPQ and triangle QRS, side PQ is equal to side RS, side QS is the common side, and side PQ is parallel to side RS. Therefore, angle PQS is equal to angle QSR because these are alternate angles. Therefore, triangle SPQ and triangle QRS are congruent according to the SAS congruence rule. The corresponding sides of congruent triangles are equal. Therefore, side SP is equal to side QR. Therefore, quadrilateral PQRS is a parallelogram. That is, if a pair of opposite sides of any quadrilateral is equal and parallel, then that quadrilateral is a parallelogram. Friends, that's all in this session. In this session, we learned some properties of a parallelogram. See you in the next video, where we will solve some questions related to this topic. Thank you. Hello friends, welcome to this video on quadrilaterals. In the previous video, we discussed about some properties of a parallelogram. Today, we will solve some questions based on that. Let's move ahead. In the given figure, quadrilateral DEFG is a parallelogram. Show that triangle DOE and triangle FOG are congruent. Triangle DGE and triangle FGE are also congruent. Friends, according to the question, DEFG is a parallelogram. Therefore, sides DE and GF will be parallel. If we consider DF a diagonal, then angle EDF and angle GFD will be alternate angles. And we know that alternate angles are equal. And we can say that in triangles DOE and FOG, angles EDO and angle GFO are equal. Angle DOE and angle FOG will be equal because both these angles are vertically opposite angles. We know that the opposite sides of a parallelogram are equal. Therefore, sides DE and FG will be equal. Now look at equations 1, 2 and 3. In both these triangles, two angles and one side is equal. But this side is not the included side of these angles. So this triangle is congruent according to the AAS congruence rule. Friends, now look at triangle DGE and triangle FEG. both of which are derived by dividing the parallelogram DEFG by diagonal GE. We know that a diagonal of a parallelogram divides it into two congruent triangles. Therefore, these two triangles will be congruent. Friends, similarly discuss triangle DGF and triangle FED with your classmates. Let's move to our next question. PQRS is a parallelogram with side SR of length 4 cm and side QR of length 3 cm. Then, find the lengths of sides PQ and PS. Friends, we know that the opposite sides of a parallelogram are equal. We are given that the quadrilateral PQRS is a parallelogram. So its opposite sides will be equal. That means side PQ is equal to side SR and the length of side SR is given as 4 cm. Therefore, the length of side PQ will also be 4 cm. Similarly, sides QR and PS will also be equal. Here we are given the length of side QR to be 3 cm. So, the length of side PS will also be 3 cm. Let's move ahead and look at another question. Quadrilateral PQRS is a parallelogram and quadrilateral PXYZ is also a parallelogram. The measure of angle R is given to be 60 degrees. Then find the measure of angle P and angle Y. According to the question, PQRS is a parallelogram and we know that the opposite angles of a parallelogram are equal. Therefore, angle P and angle R will be equal. The measure of angle R is given to be 60 degrees. So, angle P will also be equal to 60 degrees. And according to the question, PXYZ is also a parallelogram. With its help, find the measure of angle Y yourself. Friends, that's all in this session. Today, we solve some questions related to some properties of a parallelogram. See you in the next video with some more similar questions. Thank you. Hello friends. Welcome to this video on quadrilaterals. In the previous video, we saw some properties of parallelograms and some examples based on them. Today, we will solve some more questions related to that. Let's start with the first question. Prove that if a diagonal of a quadrilateral bisects the other diagonal perpendicularly, then that quadrilateral is a kite. Friends, first of all, let's draw a figure according to the statement. Suppose ABCD is a quadrilateral and diagonal AC is bisecting diagonal BD perpendicularly at point O. We have to prove that quadrilateral ABCD is a kite. Friends, if in a quadrilateral two distinct pairs of adjacent sides are equal, then that quadrilateral is called a kite. So, if we prove that side AB is equal to side AD and side CD is equal to side BC, then it will be a kite. So, let's take triangle AOB and triangle AOD. Here, side AO is the common side. We are given that diagonal AC is bisecting diagonal BD perpendicularly. So, angle AOB is equal to angle AOD, each being right angles, and side OB is equal to side OD. Thus, these triangles are congruent according to the SAS congruence rule. The corresponding sides of congruent triangles are equal, so side AB is equal to side AD. Similarly, we can prove side BC to be equal to side CD. Therefore, quadrilateral ABCD is a kite. Now let's take the next question. On the given figure, quadrilateral PQRS is a rhombus and the measure of sides QR and OQ are given to be 5 cm and 3 cm respectively. Now find the length of diagonal PR. Friends, first we will take into account all the properties of a rhombus. A rhombus is also a parallelogram whose opposite sides are equal and parallel. Diagonals of a rhombus bisect each other perpendicularly. That is, triangle QOR is a right angle triangle. By taking triangle QOR, we can find the length of side OR using the Pythagoras theorem. So in triangle QOR, the square of side QR will be equal to the square of QO plus the square of side OR, according to the Pythagoras theorem. Now, if we keep the value of these sides, we get OR is equal to 4 cm. And since PO is equal to OR, therefore PO will be equal to 4 cm. Diagonal PR is equal to PO plus OR. Therefore, we get the length of the diagonal PR equal to 8 cm. Now let's move to the last question of this session. In quadrilateral ABCD, side AB is parallel to side DC. Side AB is equal to side DC. Angle BAC equals 40 degrees and angle B equals 80 degrees. Find the values of angle DCA and angle D. Friends, we know that when a pair of opposite sides of a quadrilateral is equal and parallel, then that quadrilateral is a parallelogram. According to the question, side AB is equal and parallel to the side DC. Therefore, quadrilateral ABCD is a parallelogram. So, angle B will be equal to angle D because the opposite angles of parallelogram are equal. So, angle D will also be 80 degrees. And since side AB is parallel to side DC and AC is the diagonal, therefore, angle BSC will be equal to angle DCA as these are alternate interior angles. Therefore, angle DCA will also be 40 degrees. Friends, let's end this session here. In this session, we solved some questions related to some properties of a parallelogram. See you in the next video. Thank you. Hello friends, welcome to this video on quadrilaterals. So far, we studied some properties of triangles and quadrilaterals. Today we will study another property of triangles, that is the midpoint theorem. Friends, draw a triangle PQR, the lengths of whose sides PQ, PR and QR are 5 cm, 6 cm and 7 cm respectively. Now, suppose the midpoint of side PQ is M and the midpoint of QR is N. That is, PM is equal to QM and QN is equal to RN. And draw a line segment MN by joining the points M and N. Can you now tell any relation between the line segment MN and the side PR? Let's see. With the help of a scale, find the length of the line segment MN. Friends, you can see that the length of the line segment MN is 3 cm, which is half the length of the side PR. That is, we can write it in this way. Can you tell any other relationship by looking at the figure? Looking at it, both these lines seem to be parallel. We can test this. Let us find the measurement of the angles, that is, angle QMN and angle MPR with the help of a protractor. The measurement of these two angles is equal. Why did we only find the measurements of angle QMN and angle MPR? You can also pause the video to think of the answer. Friends, we know that these two angles are corresponding angles, formed by the intersection of the line segments MN and PR with the transversal PQ. If we use the converse of the corresponding angles axiom here, then we can say that the line segment MN and side PR are parallel. Friends, you can repeat this activity by taking some more triangles. Now, you will reach to the conclusion that the line segment joining the midpoints of any two sides of a triangle is parallel to the third side. This is what we call the midpoint theorem. We can prove this mathematically as well. Let's see how. Now, we draw a figure with the help of the statement. In triangle ABC, the midpoints of the sides AB and AC are P and Q respectively. This is given to us. And we have to prove that the line segment PQ is parallel to the side BC. Let's see the proof. We have to make a construction here. Extend the line PQ to the point R in such a way that PQ equals QR. In this way, we can join R and C. Here, we get two triangles, triangle AQP and triangle CQR. In this, the side PQ is equal to the side QR. And we are given that point Q is the midpoint of the side AC. Therefore, the sides AQ and CQ will be equal. Angle AQP and angle CQR will be equal because these are vertically opposite angles. By looking at equations 1, 2 and 3, we can say that these two triangles are congruent according to the SAS criteria for the congruency of triangles. And we know that corresponding measures of congruent triangles are equal. Hence, angle PAQ and angle RCQ will be equal. And these two sides will also be equal. Friends, these two angles are alternate angles, which are formed by the intersection of the sides BA and CR with the transversal AC. And we know that if a transversal intersects two lines in such a way that a pair of corresponding angles is equal, then both the lines are parallel to each other. Hence, the side BA will be parallel to the side CR. As we can see in the figure, points B, P and A are linear, or we can say that they are on the same line. Therefore, we can say that the side PB will also be parallel to the side CR. And we are given that side AP is equal to the side PB and side AP is also equal to the side CR. Hence, the sides PB and CR will also be equal. Friends, look at the quadrilateral PBCR. It has a pair of opposite sides, parallel and equal. And we have learned that a quadrilateral is a parallelogram if a pair of its opposite sides is equal and parallel. Therefore, using this theorem, we can say that it is a parallelogram. Hence, the sides PR and BC will be parallel and equal. Here, points P, Q and R are linear, that is, on the same line. Hence, the line segment PQ and the side BC will also be parallel. In this way, we prove the midpoint theorem. Friends, we got to know that PQ and QR are equal. Hence, we can write it like this, and from equation 6, PR and BC are also equal. Here, if we write BC in the place of PR, we get the side PQ as half of the side BC. Friends, the point to note here is that the length of the line segment formed by joining the midpoints of the two sides is always half the length of the third side. Will the converse of this theorem also be true? Does a line drawn from the midpoint of one side of a triangle parallel to the other side bisect the third side? Friends, you can perform an activity for this. In triangle XYZ, side YZ is 8 cm, side XZ is 6 cm, and the side XY is 5 cm. Point T is the midpoint of the side YZ. Line segment TS is parallel to the side XY. So, will the point S in here be the midpoint of the side XZ? With the help of scale, try to find it yourself. And you will see that point S is the midpoint of the side XZ. And here also, the length of the line segment TS is half the length of the side XY. You can repeat this activity for other triangles as well. Now, you will come to the conclusion that the converse of the theorem is also true. That is, a line drawn from the midpoint of one side of a triangle parallel to the other side bisects the third side. Try to prove it with the help of friends and teachers. Friends, that's all in today's session. Today we discussed and proved the midpoint theorem. See you in the next video with some questions based on this. Thank you. Hello friends. Welcome to this video on quadrilaterals. In the previous video, we learned about the midpoint theorem. Today, we will solve some questions related to that. Let's start with our first question. In triangle ABC, points X, Y, and Z are the midpoints of sides AB, BC, and AC respectively. If AB is equal to 5 cm, AC is equal to 9 cm, and BC is equal to 11 cm, then find the length of sides XY, YZ, and XZ and the perimeter of XYZ. Let's see. Friends, we are given that in triangle ABC, points X and Y are the midpoints of sides AB and BC respectively. If we use the midpoint theorem here, then we can say that the line segment XY is parallel to side AC and equal to half its length. We are given the measurement of AC as 9 cm. Here, we can find the measurement of XY by substituting the value of AC. We get the value of XY as 4.5 cm. Similarly, points X and Z are the midpoints of sides AB and AC respectively. Using the midpoint theorem, we can write it this way. The measurement of BC is 11 cm, from which we can find the measurement of XZ. We will get XZ as 5.5 cm. Similarly, you can find the measurement of YZ by yourself. For this, you can also pause the video and check your answer. We will get YZ equal to 2.5 cm. And we know that the perimeter of any triangle is equal to the sum of its three sides. Therefore, we can write the perimeter of triangle XYZ as follows. And by substituting the values of XY, YZ and XZ here, we can find the perimeter. Thus, we get the perimeter of triangle XYZ as 12.5 cm. Friends, look at the figure carefully. Here, in triangle ABC, four triangles are being formed. What can we tell about these triangles and their perimeter? Think about this question together with your friends. You can also take help from your teacher. Let's move on to our next question. Prove that the quadrilateral formed by joining the midpoints of any quadrilateral is a parallelogram. Friends, let's first draw a figure with the help of the question. ABCD is a quadrilateral. Points P, Q, R and S are the midpoints of sides AB, BC, CD and DA respectively. We are given this and we have to prove that the quadrilateral PQRS formed by joining these points is a parallelogram. Friends, when can PQRS be a parallelogram? When a pair of its opposite sides are parallel and equal. So, let's prove it. Let's make a construction here. Draw a diagonal BD. Now, let's see its proof. We have two triangles. In triangle ABD, points S and P are the midpoints of sides AD and AB respectively. Hence, PS and BD are parallel and PS is half the length of side BD. Similarly, in triangle DBC, point Q and point R are the midpoints of sides BC and DC respectively. Therefore, using the midpoint theorem, we can say that sides QR and BD will be parallel and side QR will be half of side BD. By looking at equations 1 and 2, we can say that in quadrilateral PQRS, one pair of sides are equal and parallel. And we know that in a quadrilateral, if one pair of opposite sides are equal and parallel, then it's a parallelogram. Therefore, quadrilateral PQRS is a parallelogram. Friends, that's all in today's session. Today we solved some questions related to midpoint theorem. See you in the next video with some facts related to this. Thank you. Hello friends, welcome to this video on quadrilaterals. In the previous video, we solved some questions related to the midpoint theorem. Today, we will discuss some facts related to that. Friends, you may recall, in the previous video, we proved that the quadrilateral formed by joining the midpoints of any quadrilateral is a parallelogram. So, will the quadrilaterals formed by joining the midpoints of a trapezium, a square, a rectangle, a rhombus be parallelograms? Let's find out. Friends, look at this trapezium ABCD. Will the quadrilateral formed by joining the midpoints of its sides be a parallelogram? In quadrilateral ABCD, if we draw a diagonal AC, then we will get two triangles, triangle ABC and triangle ADC. Friends, in triangle ABC, point R and point S are the midpoints of sides AB and BC respectively. If we use the midpoint theorem here, then the line segment RS will be parallel to side AC and half in length of side AC. Similarly, in triangle ADC, we can use the midpoint theorem and say that TQ is parallel to side AC and half its length. Friends, look at equations 1 and 2. Now we can say that RS is parallel and equal to TQ. And we know that if a pair of opposite sides of any quadrilateral is parallel and equal, then it is a parallelogram. Therefore, RSQT is a parallelogram. Friends, the second quadrilateral DEFG is a square. Will the quadrilateral LMNO formed by joining its midpoints also be a parallelogram? Yes. Here too, by making the diagonal DF, we can get two triangles DEF and DGF. You can also make the diagonal GE. And by using the midpoint theorem in both the triangles, we can say that LM is parallel and equal to ON. Therefore, quadrilateral LMNO will be a parallelogram. Friends, look at this quadrilateral carefully. Will this be a square? Pause the video with the help of a scale and a protractor. Find the measurement of its sides and angles. You will see that this is also a square. Similarly, try yourself for the rectangle and rhombus and come to a conclusion with the help of your classmates and teachers. Let's look at one more question. In the given figure, quadrilateral ABCD is a parallelogram. In which point E and point F are the midpoints of sides BC and DC respectively? And point G is the midpoint of diagonal AC. Based on the given information, state the options that are correct. Friends, let's check the first option. Look at the triangle ACB in the figure. point E and point G are the midpoints of sides BC and AC respectively. Therefore, according to the midpoint theorem, side GE is parallel to side AB and is half its length. That is, we can write it this way. Friends, you can see that our first option is correct. Now we shall look at the second option. We are given that ABCD is a parallelogram. So sides AD and BC will be equal. And point E is the midpoint of side BC. Therefore, BE will be equal to EC. We can write BC in this way. We can substitute EC in place of BE. Friends, you can see that we get AD equal to 2EC. That is, the second option is also correct. Now let's look at the third option. Friends, this is quite easy. Pause the video and check it yourself. We are given that ABCD is a parallelogram and the opposite sides of a parallelogram are equal. But both these sides are adjacent sides. If these would be equal, then quadrilateral ABCD would have been a rhombus, which is not the case. Therefore, this option is incorrect. Friends, that's all in today's session. Today we discussed some facts related to the midpoint theorem. See you in the next video. Thank you.